Hello, Richard Cassaro, you there?
Hey, Andrew, how's it going?
Could be better, could be worse. Glad the Mercury retrograde is coming to an end. It's nice the fall equinox is about to start. This is a great time for the end of a lot of things, start of a lot of new things, and well, I found out that I've been requested to come on Capricorn Radio TV, which is, I believe, listener-supported, which has been a dream for me for quite a while. So that's a great sign. I think the timing couldn't have been better. So I'm doing great, so things could be better. I don't think things could be a lot worse, but hey, that's the cliche answer I usually give. So it's great to have you on. I'm not going to be doing any sort of a news segment on this show. This show is recording. The recorder did say it's working. Just out of curiosity, are you recording at your end?
No.
It's okay. Okay, it's okay, because we're not going to miss it or anything, because I know the Skype recorder is working. It said that. So I will have this show uploaded on Blog Talk probably tomorrow, Friday at the absolute latest. And, well, I don't remember who it was who recommended you. I think it may have been Sean Cohen. Not 100% sure on that one. But your website, seeing what you talk about here, it's definitely stuff that I am very fascinated by. Although I must say, with all the Freemason, Illuminati stuff, ever since the Earth has gone through much higher vibrational frequency rising over the more recent times, my amount of time talking on my radio show about like things like conspiracies and Illuminati has actually decreased and waned in the more recent times than like when I first started doing the show. But I believe that is only a natural consequence to the fact that Earth's vibrational frequency is rising and the powers that be are, for all intents and purposes, acting like rats in a trap basement, as Ted Marr likes to say. But that does not mean that the information that you give on your sites, be it Illuminati specific or not, because I know there's a lot of things we could talk about. Lost ancient wisdom doesn't necessarily mean secret societies. There's a whole slew of things here. But I see you do have two different websites. I guess instead of waiting till the end to do this, we could do this at the beginning of the show. Why don't you tell us what's the difference between deepertruth.com, subtitle Forbidden Ancient Wisdom Revealed, and richardcassaro.com, subtitle Discovery and Revival of Lost Ancient Wisdom. So tell us about those two websites and also how people can reach you, and then we'll go from there.
Sure. Yeah. The deepertruth.com website is a website that I've had since I think about 2000 or 1999 or 2001. I think it was 1999, but that's been sort of my long-term website, and it's kind of hard to let that go because I've been publishing so much information on that website, you know, little by little over the years, and taking it down and publishing it and taking it down and that type of stuff. So that's just what I turned that into, was just my publishing company website. So that's just got some basic books on there and not too much more, some articles and not too much more. The richardcassaro.com website, I think I put that up in 2008 or 2009. I'm not sure which, but that's, I decided would be the new website where I post articles, videos, also my books and my other writings, but I decided that I just wanted the richardcassaro.com to be my main website. And so little by little, I just started putting more information onto the richardcassaro.com website. And so that's my main website, I guess you could say.
Cool. Just, you know, I'm going to be on mute whenever you're talking, so nobody hears me breathing or anything like that. So I guess we'll start off talking about secret societies, and I got to tell you a little story here about just shows how lost in a trance some people can actually be. Back in what year was it? I think it was like 2013, where I was standing by the polls on election day, and it was like a May election day, and some guy who was there too, he was always he had always supported the government and everything, and I had told him that the official story of 9/11 is a lie, and he thinks I was crazy, and he was like, "Dude, we all saw those planes hit those buildings." And I told him, "Dude, you got it all wrong. The planes were not real. The planes were holograms." And he gave me a look like, "You're crazy." And he said, "You realize how ridiculous that sounds?" And I told him, "No, I don't realize that because it's a provable fact." And then I got into a whole talk to him about how this world is filled with illusion, nothing is what it seems, and all that. And I told him that the American government, as well as every other national government on planet Earth, is bought, paid for, and controlled by a consortium of mega banks, mega corporations, and secret societies, which are in turn run by 13 major bloodline families and many smaller, minor bloodline families that are concocting evil plans for global totalitarian government. And you know what the guy actually said to me? He said to me, "Whoa, dude, how can those societies be called secret societies when people know about them?" I wanted to do a double facepalm after that, but because I realized just how lost in a trance that guy actually was. I mean, anybody who knows what's going on knows that the reason secret societies are called secret societies is not because people don't know about them. People know about them. It's just that a lot of the people that are in the secret societies, well, all the people, I guess I should say, try to keep the information in the that's discussed in the secret society meetings. A secret. Try not to get it put out to the world, but that most certainly does not mean the secret societies don't exist. However, I must say that many times I have heard people say something to that effect, like how could societies be called secret societies and people know about them? And I don't know if it's a if they're trying to show how stupid or ignorant they are, or if it's just a cop out for not wanting to learn the truth or whatever. But I guess for those that are really lost in a trance, maybe you can help people make sense of this. Okay, like secret societies, how do they become known about them? Who are the best sources? What are the best sources for bringing people to the realization that secret societies are real and they do exist, and that the reason they're called secret is because of the stuff that's hidden behind closed doors?
Yeah, it's a good question, and there's a lot of misinformation and disinformation about secret societies, you know, quote unquote. As far as I understand it, and this is, you know, my understanding, and I'm not saying that this is the way it is, but I've been studying it for many, many years, and you know, secret societies go back hundreds and hundreds of years. You know, just if we talk about the Freemasons, for example, just as one example. As far as I can see, the reason why the Freemasons originated as a secret society was because they were in possession of wisdom or ancient teachings that were disallowed by the church. And we have to remember that, you know, the church, the Inquisition, the Holy See, they had all the power. Those guys were in control, you know, Spanish Inquisition, and they killed people who were not followers, or who didn't bow down to their religion, or who didn't convert to their religion, or who were practicing their own religion in secret. So there were men who, and I'm sure women as well, but there were men who believed that in something different than what the church was teaching, or had visions, or had spiritual experiences and things like that. And so there was really no place for them to go if there was not a free society. They lived in a time of censorship, and they lived in a time where the church had all the power. So as far as I've studied, and you know, I've studied pretty extensively on this, these secret societies like the Freemasons evolved as places where people who were spiritually minded or metaphysically minded, or you know, in some way didn't believe in what the church was teaching, could go and learn about deeper metaphysical truths, spiritual truths, etc. And so the Freemasons evolved that way. I can tell you that from my research, I've looked at the church architecture, and the Freemasons, as far as I've studied and as far as I can tell you, you know, my experience and my research, they built the Gothic cathedrals. The Freemasons, there's a direct link between Freemasonry and Gothic cathedrals, the Gothic cathedrals. And much ancient wisdom is encoded in those Gothic cathedrals. There's a tremendous amount of ancient wisdom encoded in the Gothic cathedrals. In fact, my research is focused on the idea that in ancient times, there was a universal religion that was shared by all the ancient cultures of the world, the Egyptians, the Maya, pre-Inca cultures in Peru, Sumerians, Persians, Chinese, Hindus, all of them had the same religion. That religion is encoded in the Gothic cathedrals, and it's also visible in the symbols and ceremonies of Freemasonry. So it's very clear that there's a direct connection between the ancient universal religion and Freemasonry. And so from what my research shows, at the time of the building of the... Hey, Andrew.
Okay, we're back. I don't know how that happened, but the recording is going on again, so let's continue. You were talking about the Gothic cathedrals.
Right. I'm not sure where it cut off, but the as far as my research shows, and I've studied this for, you know, more than a couple of decades now, but the ancient universal religion, the ancient worldwide religion, is encoded into the Gothic cathedrals, in the Gothic cathedral architecture, in the symbolism of the Gothic cathedrals, in the layout and the design. It's all there. And so what I can say for sure, as far as I believe, is that the builders and the designers of the Gothic cathedrals were, in some way, had inherited the ancient universal religion, the ancient lost doctrine of antiquity, the ancient teachings of Hinduism, the ancient teachings of the Egyptians, the ancient teachings even of the New World cultures, because it was all the same wisdom. And so at some point between then and now, those secret societies were hijacked. Those secret societies ceased being brotherhoods where people could go and learn spiritual wisdom or metaphysical teachings, and began being places where the truth is no longer taught, or where the symbols are now subverted or not taught correctly, or it's more of a eating and drinking society. It's more of a friendship society. It's more of a place where people talk about morality rather than spirituality, a place where people don't really go to dig for answers that it once was. So I found that there was an affair, the Morgan affair. There was an incident in the 1800s where, this is where I think it was a kind of a false flag operation or some type of event that happened that changed Freemasonry. And I don't really want to go into the Morgan affair, but just as a quick, there was an incident where for about 30 or 40 years, Freemasonry became a very controversial topic. Lodges were closed. Ceremonies were changed. It was a big conflagration there. And in the 1860s, it started around 1830. And in the 1860s, Freemasonry was born again. And I think when it was born again, it was dumbed down completely. And I think at that point, we could say that before that point, it was the founding fathers were Freemasons, famous names that were Freemasons. And they were, in my opinion, they were good, righteous people, people who were interested in truth, intelligent people. And then after that point, it was still good people, but they were joining a fraternity that had been in many ways emasculated, or in many ways dumbed down, and it no longer had the wisdom of antiquity. It has it still in the symbolism, but it's not taught anymore in the outward ritual or in the lectures and things like that. So, and I think after that, at some point, it was used by, you know, it started getting infiltrated, and people started to use it as a place where they could kind of hatch their schemes. People probably even used it to say, you know, we have our ideas, let's join the Freemasons, we'll concoct our plans there, and the Freemasons can take the heat. So I think there's a lot of misunderstanding, and I think there's a lot of disinformation out there. People want to blame the Freemasons, and I think that's totally wrong. I think if you read my book, Written in Stone, I think it's very – I put it out there very, very, very clearly that the cathedrals all say the same message, and that message is a Masonic message, and that message is a message of antiquity, which is there – you know, there's a spirituality to all of us, and there's a morality to all of us, and we all have good parts of us and bad parts of us, and it kind of teaches you how to maneuver through life knowing this duality of man. And so it's a lot of valuable information. So to say that secret societies in general were bad, I think that's, you know, it goes a little deeper than that. Does that make sense, Andrew?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And First of all, I'm just going to go out on a limb and say that I think the little glitch there we had was the last bits of the Mercury retrograde that were in, just getting its last hurrah in there, causing a little glitch there. Hopefully it won't be a problem anymore. But yeah, that did all make sense. I'm very familiar with the whole Gothic cathedral thing, and I did interview Jay Widener. He talked about this in greater detail because he wrote a he's written books about it, written articles, worked with Vincent Bridges, who's also talked about the Gothic cathedral thing. And interesting thing about Gothic cathedrals, I'm quite familiar with them. I see a Gothic cathedral very often when I go for a walk. The Bryn Athyn Gothic cathedral, which is basically the de facto headquarters of the Swedenborgian faith, the General Church of the New Jerusalem, which is a Swedenborgian faith, a sect of Christianity. No cross is involved in that religion. Emanuel Swedenborg was the founder. He was a Freemason. And interesting thing is the Bryn Athyn, the richest family in Bryn Athyn is the Pitcairn family. There's a lot of incest going on there. I can't help but wonder if the Pitcairn family has Illuminati connections. I hope the people of Bryn Athyn don't get on my ass for saying this, but I gotta ask you, since I'm talking to you right now, are you familiar in any way with the Gothic Cathedral and the Freemasonic connections, the Swedenborgian connections involving Bryn Athyn, where I live near?
No.
Oh, you haven't researched that. All right, well, maybe something worth looking into if you get a chance. Other than that, the Gothic Cathedrals, they are said to be able to harness energy. The way they're designed, Jay Widener talked about this when I interviewed him, the way they are designed allows for energy to be harnessed from the cosmos, from the surrounding area of the cathedral, be it in the cosmos, in the down-to-earth, wherever it may be, and bring it down to the ground so that people in the cathedral and I guess the surrounding area would be able to utilize it in metaphysical ways. Are you familiar with this phenomenon? And if so, enlighten us on how it works.
Okay, well, I'm mainly interested in things that could be proven, but I have read about this idea before, and I am not able, as it's impossible to prove, obviously, but the idea here is just one idea. I mean, there's a lot of different ideas according to different authors that I've read over the centuries. You know, authors have written about this type of thing. But there's not a consistent idea where they say, if you go to this Gothic cathedral and you stand here, you'll feel that, you know, there's nothing like that. So it's very, very difficult to say, well, you know what? I read this in a book in the 1800s by this author. He told me to go to this cathedral and stand in this place and to meditate, and I would feel that I'm ascending on the plains. It's not like that. So it's just speculation. But a general idea is that the Gothic cathedrals, or some of them, were built on much more ancient structures. And the whole idea is that ancient cultures were much more spiritually advanced than we are today, which is something I believe. Now, that's gotten confused these days with technology. A lot of people say they were technologically advanced. I don't think there's any evidence of that at all. I think that the great monuments that we see in antiquity are much, much more advanced than anything we have today because the people were spiritually advanced, not technologically advanced. And we see that in the pyramids and the monuments like Stonehenge and ruins in the New World like Sacsayhuaman in Peru and things like that. But anyway, just to say the ancients were much more advanced than we are today and spiritually advanced. And so they knew that there were places in the world, spots where, for example, ley lines would meet or ley lines would cross. And it's almost like chakras on the human body where there were places of power. And so they built their monuments on those places of power. And the Gothic cathedral builders and even the people that came before the cathedral builders, and they saw the monuments and they decided either to enhance the monuments or maintain the monuments. And anyway, this evolved into where cathedrals would be built, churches would be built. If you look around the world, churches are usually built on mounds, or at least on a high ground. But the idea here is that these ancient places of power retain their energy and retain their, for whatever reason that they're charged with energy, it retains that. And it's possible that the designers and builders of the Gothic cathedrals and other churches around the world knew how to harness that. And that could be, you know, one reason why the cathedrals are designed in a north-south axis, east-west. The western facade faces east. And it's a symbolic idea for sure. But there might even be an idea that's connected with the idea of ley lines and grabbing energy. Hey, Andrew.
Here we go again. Like I said, Mercury retrogrades, last hurrah. Or maybe it's technical gremlins in the NSA don't want me talking to you and getting this valuable information out. But if that's the case, let's just keep a stiff upper lip no matter how many times this happens and keep going. All right, so the you were talking about the alignments with the stars and whatnot.
Yeah, so the idea, it's been out there, and I've studied it. I've been to many Gothic cathedrals on different continents, many cathedrals on different continents, and the Gothic cathedrals in Europe. And I have to say that, you know, there are certain points in the churches, in the cathedrals, where it almost looks like the Masons told you, see this circle on the ground? You should stand there. And when you stand there and when you meditate, or when you stand there and when you try to absorb the power and breathe it in, you do feel a little bit something, a little different, a little special. I probably would not go too far into that because it's not easily proven. It's not scientifically proven. And I mean, it's an interesting topic, but it's hard to convince somebody if they've never actually, if you're not leading a tour to that place where you have 10 people and you could say, watch this, stand right here. How do you feel? Meditate for a second, take it, breathe it in. Do you feel something special? I mean, that's a little tough. So, there's a body of literature that talks about this phenomenon, but it's not really proven and it's not really specific.
Awesome. And looking at another book that you've written, The Missing Link, A Powerful New Evidence of an Advanced Golden Age Culture in Prehistoric Antiquity, I need to try to get the dates straightened out here because there seems to be some confusion about this. I recently read Michael Tsarian's book, Atlantis, Alien Visitation and Genetic Manipulation. I do not resonate with Tsarian's claim that Atlantis and Lemuria coexisted around the same time. That doesn't seem right. Most vast majority of other people say Lemuria came before Atlantis. However, Tsarian makes the bold assertion in his book that there was an ice age that came to an end about 13,000 years ago. Don't remember exactly how long it lasted. My science and history is a little rusty on that. But how this ice age that was said to have ended came to an end about 13,000 years ago, coinciding with the great galactic alignment like we had in 2012, although that one 13,000 years ago was on the summer solstice, not the winter solstice like in 2012. Tsarian claims that ice age never actually existed. He says the story of an ice age was to conceal the fact that Atlantis, and he also claims Lemuria, existed on the Earth during that time period. Lots of people, including some guy that I had on my show, Frank Joseph Hoff, have claimed that Atlantis would have had to have existed somewhere where the temperature on the Earth was temperate and convenient, and Frank Joseph Hoff made the bold claim that Atlantis actually existed in the Indonesian area. I'm not really inclined to believe that. I'm more inclined to believe that Atlantis may have had global colonies around the world, and Indonesia and Egypt and some parts of South America may have been places where they had outposts and such, but they weren't headquartered in Indonesia. And my take on it is the fact that there was an ice age on Earth, if it existed, didn't really pose any sort of a problem to the people of Atlantis because they were of a very high spiritual consciousness, as you explained earlier. So they could, if they wanted to, suck it up and overpower the ice age and all the trials and tribulations and dilemmas that comes with living in an ice age simply because they are of a very high consciousness essence. However, Tsarian did say that There never was an ice age. He thinks it's a mainstream science, mainstream history lie, and the people of Atlantis didn't actually have to worry about that. And he does, in his book, provide compelling evidence for it, not just in the main part, but also in one of the appendixes of his book, Atlantis: Alien Visitation and Genetic Manipulation. So, looking at the of an He says the subtitle here, Powerful New Evidence of an Advanced Golden Age Culture. What time period are you talking about in prehistoric antiquity there? And what is your take on this agree to disagree kind of situation with whether or not an ice age did or did not exist that came to an end supposedly 13,000 years ago?
Well, it's a great question. The Ice Age, the catastrophes that happened thousands of years ago, that really, for me, falls more into the science of geology and that type of stuff, which is not something that I really study, and it doesn't really interest me too much. Lemuria is very interesting to me, and I've looked at different traditions that talked about it that, they say that the idea really doesn't stretch further back to the 1800s. And I've seen some very sparse evidence that, in fact, it does, but it's very, very difficult to prove, and it's very, very difficult to believe that a place called Lemuria existed. And, I think I'm much more interested in Atlantis because the idea has much, much deeper roots. It goes back to antiquity. It goes back to Plato, 600 BC, and not only Plato, but a lot of people don't realize, but a lot of the Greek philosophers and the ancient philosophers talked about Atlantis. There was Cranter, Strabo, Posidonius, I should say, and there were a couple more that I don't. I think there was Proclus, and I think it was one other, but there were more than just Plato talked about Atlantis. So there's a lot of antiquity and roots that go with the Atlantis hypothesis or idea or theory. The whole idea of there being an Atlantic Ocean too. I mean, it kind of makes sense, and you remember the Victorian era scholars, late 1800s, they all believed when they were uncovering ruins in the jungles of Mexico and when they were uncovering ruins in Peru, pyramids, mummies, corbelled arches, gold artifacts, they looked exactly like what archaeologists had been digging up for hundreds of years in the old world, in Egypt, in places like Mesopotamia. So they said, we're seeing parallel civilizations on both sides of the Atlantic. Is it possible that this is the evidence of Atlantis that that our forefathers always told us about? So there's a much stronger reason to believe in Atlantis than there is in Lemuria. In terms of you had mentioned when is the Golden Age? It's hard to put a date on it, but the reason why I do believe in a golden age, excuse me, is because there is a Hindu tradition of the Yuga cycles, and it's not just in Hinduism. There's some other traditions in the world that talk about it. Specifically, there's the Hopi Indians, and there's the Maya believed in it as well. The Greeks also talked about there was a golden age, and it followed by the Silver Age, Bronze Age, and then the Iron Age. In India, it's the most developed and it's the most interesting. They have the Satya Yuga, which is the golden, the Treta Yuga, which is the silver. Then it falls down into the Dwapara Yuga, which is the bronze, and then the Kali Yuga, which is the Iron Age, the worst one of them all. And the whole idea here is that way back in time, there was a golden age. There was a great time when people were much more spiritually advanced than we are today. Over time, the consciousness began to fall. And that turned into the Silver Age. And again, it fell again over time, and that turned into the Bronze Age. And then it fell once more not too long ago, which is why we are now living in the Kali Yuga age, where everything is backwards. Everything is turned around. There's a great Michael Elner quote. Are you familiar with it? I don't remember exactly what it says, but you know what? I think I have it somewhere. Let me take a quick look.
I'm
I'm
not
online
familiar
right
with it,
now.
so take your time.
It, everything is backwards. Everything is upside down. Doctors destroy
Oh,
health.
that quote. I've known that quote.
You've heard
Yes.
that.
Yeah, I've heard
Okay.
that.
So,
Great quote.
it explains beautifully why we're living in this time, why things are so backwards, why the world seems so violent and greedy, and why you know, it's so difficult just to just sometimes just to get along, you know. So I was always interested in that idea. It's not something that I've just recently picked up, and so I discussed it in my research. And also from books that I've read, this is a concept in the esoteric tradition. This is a concept in the Hermetic tradition, that civilization was much more advanced back, you know, in the Golden Age and back in the time when people had higher consciousness. And so it really makes a lot of sense. Now, this idea has been hijacked lately by all the people that say that there was a high technology back then. There wasn't a high technology. It wasn't about technology at all. It was about spirituality. In fact, if you go back to Plato, which is where the Atlantis idea came.
All right, hey. It's recording again, so hopefully after 10 minutes it won't happen, but what you were saying, that thing Plato said?
Yeah, it's – hold on 1 second. Let me think about it. But when the divine – when the divine element in them became weakened and their human traits became predominant, they ceased to be able to carry their prosperity with moderation. That's Plato. And he says that quote in Critias. It's a very important quote because – he's telling us the whole basis of the Atlantis idea is that the Atlanteans, or the people of the Golden Age, stopped being spiritual and became much more material. They began to identify with the human trait rather than the spiritual, divine trait within them, which is the soul within. It's a very important quote because it's showing us that the whole drop from the golden down to the silver, down to the bronze, down to where we are today, is because we're becoming more animalistic. We're becoming less spiritual and more animalistic. We're identifying more with the physical part rather than the spiritual part. And so, again, you know, a short look online today and everybody's kind of convinced that the ancients had this high technology, and it wasn't that at all. In fact, everything that the people are pointing to today and saying that the ancients had a high technology is made of stone, okay? And that's a very, very important thing to remember. All the monuments that they're pointing to, the pyramids of Egypt, made of stone. Sacsayhuaman in Peru, made of stone. Baalbek in Lebanon, made of stone. Everything was made of stone. Why? Because ancient cultures were stonemason cultures. And what do we have today that matches that? Freemasonry, master masons. The whole idea is that being a master mason is not being a master mason means that you are a master, you are a centered individual, you've balanced your opposites, you've awakened your third eye. This is what all the symbolism in Freemasonry teaches. This is what all the architecture in the Gothic cathedral teaches. You're an awakened soul. You've opened your third eye. You've seen your soul within. You've recognized your internal divinity and eternity. You are a master of your lower appetites. You know how to assimilate the dark side in yourself and to raise it up and make it a part of your whole one being and not be debased by it. I mean, you've controlled your appetites. This is all Freemasonry. This is all Master Masonry. You are able to take a rough stone and turn it into a perfect ashlar. And then you're able to put that ashlar into a masterful building, whatever it might be. It might be a pyramid. It might be an aqueduct. It might be a temple, but you are able to work with others and put that one rough stone into a perfect stone, perfect ashlar, and incorporate that into a magnificent building. This is what the ancients did. This is what Master Masonry is all about. And so the idea that they had, you know, these cranes and all kinds of technology, special drills, things like this, electricity, it doesn't really play into that. What it seems that they had was an unbelievably heightened sense of self. What it seems they had was that they were incredibly spiritual, and they were incredibly skilled at what they were doing each day, which was being builders. They were building. And so what I've done in my work is I've been able to match the master masonry, this masterful stone masonry of different cultures in antiquity with the modern concept of Freemasonry. And I show how the Masonic fraternity really has inherited the symbolism, the architecture, the philosophy of the ancients. And as I said before, all the ancient cultures shared the same universal religion, and this universal religion has been inherited by the Freemasons. And it's in the symbols of Freemasonry, it's in the architecture of the cathedrals and other architecture as well. I don't know if you've looked at my work on the triptych temple. It's the three doors that we find among the pyramid cultures of antiquity across the world. Freemasons have that as well. They designed and built it into the Gothic cathedrals, and you'll also find it all over the modern Masonic buildings.
Well, I guess we might as well make that the next thing we talk about. I do have your site up here, and one of the things on the articles here is the triptych temples of Atlantis, unprecedented new archaeological evidence that a highly advanced lost civilization flourished in a remote age older than recorded time. And talk about, did the world's first cultures inherit the same high wisdom from the same more ancient but now vanished mother culture? You have the Serpent Pyramid in Mexico at Chichen Itza. Then there's one of these pyramids in Egypt, not one of the Great Pyramids and such, but it's more like a stepped pyramid. And then there's one in Cambodia. And the ancient pyramid cultures all built these three-door triptych temples. Does this mean they shared the same religion? And you do connect links, draw some links here, and I see some like mummies or such of people that were their bodies were after they died, they were mummified in some way in both Mexico, Egypt, and Cambodia. And lots of links here, and at the very bottom of the page I see a picture of the Last Supper, the whole Da Vinci Code thing. So I guess now's your chance. Why don't you elaborate on this in much greater detail?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's very clear to me, and it was always very clear to me ever since I've been very young, even before I was a teenager, that the pyramids around the world were all connected. And it's not just the pyramids. The pyramids are just the tip of the iceberg. There are, as I explain in those photos that I put together, there are much greater parallels, the triptych temple being the greatest of them all. But the pyramids is an important parallel because that's what most people know about and most people recognize. But mummification was also a worldwide phenomenon. The corbel arches were also a worldwide phenomenon. Those were discovered in the 1800s by the Victorian scholars. They connected it to Atlantis. They connected the pyramids to Atlantis. They connected mummification to Atlantis. I read all the books when I was very, very young, when I was a teenager, and so I was always interested in the idea. I'm more interested in the similarities that ancient cultures share, because it's impossible to actually find Atlantis. You know, it's supposedly buried in the ocean from the flood, you know, the submersion of the continent under the waters. So I'm not much into scuba diving. So I'm more into philosophy and comparative religion and also architecture and that type of stuff. So what I've been able to do is been able to find the similarities of ancient cultures. And then more deeply than that, I look at the philosophies and the religions behind the architectural parallels, behind the parallels, for example, between the Maya and the Egyptians. And they had the same religion. It's the same exact religion. I use the words of scholars when I point that out. You know, I have, for example, just as one example, the Egyptians and the Mayans both believed that the human body is symmetrical and the left side of the body is the sinister side, the evil side, the devil on our left shoulder kind of telling us to do evil. And then they believed that on the right side was the positive side, the sun side, the good angel on our right shoulder telling us to do good. You'll find that in every single ancient culture. And that's the concept of duality. And then, of course, in between that concept of left and right, or sun and moon, or right and wrong, day and night, you'll have this middle idea of balance, balancing of the two. It's only through the balance of the two that you recognize that the two are really one phenomenon, wholeness. And that's the center door of the triptych. That's the whole idea of the triptych, is there's three doors. The left and the right door, the two extreme doors, are the two yin and yang sides, the good and the evil, the right and the wrong, the left and the right. The left side of your body and the right side of your body. It's only when you're able to see that they're both united, in fact, is when you walk through the middle door. That's when you find your so-called Christ within, or soul within. You recognize the wholeness of all creation. You recognize that the two extreme parts of the duality are really the twin sides of the same coin. And so it's a concept of balance right there, and wholeness. And that's why Da Vinci, who I believe was initiated into these ideas, he put the triptych in the Last Supper for exactly this reason. You know, he understood the idea of the triptych. He understood the antiquity of it. He understood that it was the premier architectural symbol of a lost ancient worldwide religion. And that's why he put it there. He put the Christ in the middle doorway to show that we all have this Christ within us, and that's the soul within, the divine spark within, if you will, the Buddha within. And, you know, in Buddhism, they have a wonderful sutra called the Tathagatagarbha Sutra. Basically, it's we all have a Buddha at the center of ourselves, but he's covered up with animalistic clothing in the form of greed and violence and appetites. And it's the goal of a bodhisattva to uncover the Buddha while in life, to take off these outer layers and until one at a time, until actually they find that Buddha nature within. It's the same really as esoteric Christianity. It's the same as the Assyrian religion.
Working now, I'm going to have to find out what's going on here. I didn't change anything on the MP3 Skype recorder settings. I don't know why it's happening at 10-minute intervals, but let's continue.
All right, I'm not sure where I left off, but did I mention the Tathagatagarbha?
Man, you made me lose my train of thought too. It's a shame this thing has to happen. I think you were finishing up the whole thing about the whole Last Supper connection.
Okay, yeah. So
I'll just start from there again.
Yep, the middle doorway is the Christ within. It's the spark within. It's the divine spark within that we have at the center between the opposites, between the left and right side, between the good and the evil, so-called, between the solar side and the lunar side. And that's very important because what Da Vinci did was a beautiful thing with the Last Supper. He also balanced it out. Christ in the center door, six apostles to his left, six to his right, in perfect balance. And he did a lot of other things there too, which I think a lot of people know about now. These days with Facebook, everybody's passing around photos of the zodiac being encoded in the Last Supper, which has been known for many, many years. I've learned that actually when I was in college. It was in my art book in college, which is about 20 years ago. And my art teacher told us about that. And so it's definitely there. He definitely encoded great wisdom into the Last Supper. But I think that the greatest thing that he did with the Last Supper was the triptych temple behind Jesus. And I also think that he aligned Jesus into the center door to show that, you know, when we do take the center door, we take the door of wholeness, we take the door of balance, and we find our Christ within through that door. But I think what is even more interesting is that he kind of put Christ in front of the door, more close to us, to show that Christianity is closer to us in time, and it's also covering up the older religion of the triptych. I think that's something that it's a message that comes through to me when I see the three doors behind Jesus. So not only did he align Christ in with the center door to kind of show that, you know, like I said, when you take the center door, you find your Christ within, but he was also saying how Christianity, the religion that incorrectly explains the antiquity of this idea, because what Christianity has done is they've taken the one man Jesus and said he is the only one that's divine. You're not divine. He is divine. Follow him. And so what I think Da Vinci was saying was Christianity has covered up this more ancient this ancient universal religion of the triptych, which I think was brilliant.
Cool. Let's switch gears here. Talk about the third eye in ancient Americas and also a third eye in ancient Egypt. The ancient Egypt one has three parts to it. I see on your videos page here, and then there's just one video here regarding the third eye in ancient Americas. Now, what's the deal with the third eye? I think there's a lot of confusion there. Is it the pineal gland, the pituitary gland, or is it a combination of the two? And is it worth using? Because George Kavaslis, who I have the utmost respect for, use him as a frequent source on my show, he actually says it's not worth it to use the third eye. You should just go with the heart all the time because you can't go wrong with the heart. The heart is where it's at. Although I think that he's being a little too... he's missing out on all the fun, all the variety, because, I mean, if he can not get bored you going with the heart chakra all the time, then more power to him. But I think just for the sake of the spice of life known as variety, you gotta use your other chakras, man, and use your third eye too. And I myself am very big on the third eye, because I'm an avid sun gazer, and that's all about enhancing the abilities of the third eye. So you specifically here did it on the ancient Americas and Egypt, but of course there's a lot more to it than just Egypt and the Americas. There's the whole thing about India with the third eye that you see a lot of women put that little dot on their forehead, of which many would assert is the symbolic of the third eye, as Hindus and Buddhists for that matter recognize to a great extent. So what's the big deal to you with the third eye and its significance around the world?
Okay, so as I was saying, the triptych temple is temples that we find all around the world, mostly with the pyramid cultures. The center door of the triptych in Freemasonry, there's been examples where the center door has an eye over it. And the eye over the center door is the third eye. It's the eye between the Ida and Pingala channels. In Hinduism, the way to awaken the third eye is to balance the two channels, the two bodily channels, Ida and Pingala, which are like yin and yang. So when you balance those two channels, you awaken the Sushumna, which is this along the spinal column of the body. And the Kundalini serpent, I'm just giving very, very broad strokes here, but Kundalini serpent awakens from its slumber in the pelvis and rises up through the chakras and awakens the Sahasra chakra through the third eye. So basically what it is the third eye is not just in Hinduism. I've found that it exists in all the cultures of the world. For example, in Egypt, the third eye is there. In the Maya culture, the third eye is there. And it's not just a minor part of the culture. I put an article out about 6 months ago, maybe a little bit more, on Graham Hancock's website, where it explains how the entire ancient Egyptian culture was founded on the idea of the balance of the opposites and the finding of the middle way and the awakening of the third eye. And they explain this through the Upper Egypt and Lower Egypt, but the entire country of Egypt was divided into Upper and Lower Egypt. And I show how these are the two dualities. Upper Egypt being the white crown, being worn, the king of Upper Egypt wore the white crown, and the king of Lower Egypt wore the red crown. And one of them is the spiritual principle, one of them is the material principle, one of, again, all the duality, good and evil, right and wrong, etc. And the idea of the union of the two lands, which is what Pharaoh was. He was the one who united the two lands. Originally, the throne was held by Osiris. He was the original uniter of the two lands. He was the Osiris. He was the Christ of his civilization, precisely because he joined the two opposites, precisely because he was the one who united the upper and lower kingdoms of Egypt into the dynastic Egypt that we know and celebrate today. And it's not just in Egypt. I found that everywhere. And so the third eye is a major, major part of ancient religions, all around the world, not just in the old world, but in the new world as well. And so it's very important because that's a major symbol in Freemasonry. It's the all-seeing eye. Again, with all the misinformation and disinformation today, people look at the symbol of the pyramid with the eye on top as some type of an Illuminati symbol, and only the people at the top know the truth. And I don't go for that too much. I really understand the true symbolism behind these symbols and the symbols, sorry. And the Masons use the symbols because that particular symbol is an example, the pyramid with the all-seeing eye on top. That's not the all-seeing eye, and it's not the eye of God. It's the third eye. And the way we know that for sure is because it's encapsulated inside of a triangle. And the triangle, if you look at the geometric form of a triangle is made of two lower points that are balanced and reconciled by a higher point centered midway between them. And that's exactly a triptych. A triptych is the two lower points that are reconciled by the higher door midway between them. So the idea of a triptych and a triangle are the same exact ideas. And so the reason why they put an eye in the triangle is to show that the triangle is the concept of the balance of the opposites. And that, of course, leads to the awakened third eye. And the reason they put it on top of a pyramid is to show that they understood, as master masons they all were, founding fathers, they understood that the great pyramids of antiquity all around the world and all the great monuments, the stone monuments of antiquity, were built by people who had an awakened third eye and who were master masons, because the whole concept of Freemasonry teaches that you have to awaken your third eye in order to reach your potential, your spiritual potential. You really have to awaken your third eye. The whole concept of the lost secret of Freemasonry, I think, hinges on the third eye. The third eye in the triangle. That's exactly what we see on the dollar bill. That's the main Masonic symbol. And so it's a very important part of my research, and I think it's starting to get out there more. I've put a lot of articles out there. I've put videos out there. And I know more and more people are awakening to this. I think my next big move is that I want people to stop really start to really understand the true history of Freemasonry and learn that the whole thing was not founded to try to start a new world order. It was founded originally as a great and noble brotherhood that was designed to keep the truth alive during the dark days of the Inquisition, to keep the ancient wisdom alive during the dark days of the Inquisition. I think we're moving on to 10 minutes here, Andrew. What do you think?
All right, we're back. Oh, good thing you're keeping track now so you don't lose your train of thought. That's cool. I'm glad you're doing that. I should do that too. But looking on your website here, Occult Secrets Behind Pinecone Art and Architecture, what's the significance behind the pinecone? Some would assert that that is directly correlated with the third eye, because it actually, the third eye sort of looks like a pinecone in some regard.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the that was one of the, you know, look, the one of the things that I wanted to say in the last segment there, the pine cone is an ancient symbol of the third eye, the pineal gland, pine cone, pineal gland, also the pineapple. But yeah, the pineal, the pine cone is symbolic of the third eye. That's an old article there. It's about 6 years old. I have that on the website back in 2010. this is an idea that I read about. In some of the, I think the first place that I read it was in Manly Hall, but other authors also talk about it. C.W. Leadbitter talks about it, Wilm Schurst, and I think I also read it I can't remember his name right now, but anyway, yeah, the pine cone has two, you might say that the pine cone has two statuses, closed and opened. And we've both seen, you know, we've all seen how a pine cone can be closed and a pine cone can be open. So the closed pine cone is when your pineal gland is closed, and the open pine cone is when your pineal gland is open. And I think I used to have a video on the website. I'm not sure if it's still there, if it works or not, but it was kind of a sped up video of a pine cone opening, which was fascinating to me. And so, yeah, the pine cone, pineal gland, pineapple, they all stand for the third eye.
Cool. And next thing here, Macy's Seven Deadly Sins, Mass Mind Control Strategies and Symbolism. Interesting you choose Macy's of all the corporations that you could possibly use to explain how they brainwash us. I must say I'm kind of ignorant of Macy's specific ways of brainwashing us, and you use the term Seven Deadly Sins here, the phrase Seven Deadly Sins. I guess there are seven different ways of doing it, so why don't you enlighten me and everybody else on this subject, and what about Macy's specifically?
Well, Macy's always stood out to me because I was always a big fan of the pentagram. I used to draw it on all my high school books, and I was always just loved the pentagram. I loved it. And I always knew from a very early age from reading books that the pentagram has hidden within it the symbol of a man, you know, the human body, a man, a woman. The top is obviously the top of the star, the five-pointed pentagram. The top is the head, the two outer points of the star, the arms, and the two lower parts of the legs. And that's no secret. That's something that I've read in books, and it's been around for ages. I think it first appeared in I think it was Tycho Brahe. I'm not really sure, but or maybe Agrippa, but I don't remember which one. But anyway, the idea has been around for a long, long time. And it's a magical symbol. If anybody, and I don't really want to get into the magic of it, anybody can type into Google and look it up. But you can use the pentagram for magical ceremonies and for different magical operations. Excuse me. So I've always been interested in the pentagram, and little by little I started to recognize the pentagram in different brands as I was growing up. And one of the most powerful way that I saw the pentagram being used was in Macy's commercials, and especially around Christmas time. Sometimes they would just put the pentagram on the screen just by itself, a big red pentagram on the screen with a white background, or sometimes they would have a big white pentagram on the screen with a red background. And then at some point, I think in my early 20s or even before that, 20 years ago, I started to notice that Macy's were using a slogan called the Magic of Macy's, the Magic of Macy's. And that really goes beautifully with the pentagram, because the pentagram is a magical symbol. And so it was very clear to me that whoever had come up with this advertising, that Macy's, you know, whoever at Macy's had come up with this advertising, really understood the pentagram and really understood the magic behind it. And not only that, but they were using that in a way that it seemed to me to fool the public, or to trick the public, or in some way to entice or lead the public into them. And there's psychological reasons for this as well. I don't really want to get into, because it's too difficult to explain, but Carl Jung talked about how we are all attracted to certain symbols, and we're attracted to those symbols for no other reason than what we have. We have a collective memory of those symbols. For example, we're all attracted to seashells, because for hundreds of thousands of years, human beings have used seashells to beautify their home. They've used seashells to as money at one point in different cultures. And so we have a positive look at seashells. We have a positive perception of seashells. And so for a company to market or use their logo as a seashell, we have a positive attraction to that already, not because we have had a personal experience with it, but because as human beings, it's almost written into our DNA, because of our great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents and so on and so forth for hundreds of thousands of years. We have this collective memory. It's an unconscious memory. We have a collective memory of the seashell being a positive symbol. And if you grew up in the U.S., then you are very familiar with Shell Gas, the gas station, Shell. And that's in another article that I wrote several years ago and put on the website, about how these types of symbols, we have kind of a predisposition to be attracted to these types of symbols. So it's not just – I have this article, Macy's, but, you know, again, Macy's with the pentagram, very powerful symbol. Pentagram is one of the most powerful symbols in the world. And also, if you go on the website, you could see Macy's even has some of their marketing and advertising where they have people, girls – in the position with a huge star behind them, and one girl is with her arms outstretched, standing in the exact position that I think it was Tycho Brahe or Agrippa's pentagram, with a man standing in the position so that his body forms the star. And Macy's did that as well. They really knew the pentagram. They understood it, and they used it in their marketing. And so the article is basically about that.
Cool. Just, you know, you were breaking up a couple of times there, not for any more than about a second and a half or so, but hopefully that won't happen again. Switching gears, heresy at Chartres, the wickedest cathedral in the world. Okay, I'm interested to know, why is this the wickedest cathedral in the world? What's going on there?
It's an old article. It's funny because always a big fan of Chartres. It's one of the most interesting cathedrals I've ever visited. There's a lot of reasons, and you know, I won't go through each one of them, but for example, just as one example, the cathedral is built on an ancient — some say it's a grotto, some say it's a cave, but whatever it was, and some say there was a river underneath there, but there was an ancient structure there since antiquity. I guess the safest way to say it is that since antiquity, okay, the location on which Chartres has been built has been a sacred site. And so that is a lot of
– Richard, I can't hear you. Yo, you cut out for like 4 whole seconds there. Oh boy. Okay, why don't you backtrack and see
We're
what
having a
you
tough
got?
one. Do you want to pause the interview? Maybe we can get the we could do the rest another time because I don't know, it doesn't seem like
Well,
we have an hour in the hole.
this is kind of normal. I mean, it's kind of expected that this is going to happen when you got a great guest on and talking about very key things and such. And
Okay, no, it's fine with me, but it sounds like you're being tortured and I feel
I'm not
bad.
being tortured at all. It's just that in about 45 seconds, the show is going to we're gonna have to hang up and call in again because of the automatic hanging up thing. So I don't really know why that's happening. And you're breaking up. Like Jordan Maxwell and I have had him on. He was breaking up for like a full whopping 4 seconds on like 6 separate occasions when I first gave him the floor at the beginning. So I mean, I can understand why they would do that to him. But tell you what, why don't I hang up on you in about 15 seconds and then call you back in and we'll see how this goes. I don't really think doing the show at a different time, at a different day, is going to make any difference in regards to whether or not the technical gremlins or whatever hassle us and whatnot.
Okay.
It could be the Mercury retrograde, but then again, that's coming to an end. So I don't know. Make of it whatever you will. So I guess. All right, it didn't say recording finished, but it probably will continue. So you were talking about Chartrace again. Let's continue.
The towers, the two tall towers that are in the entrance of the cathedral are they are incredibly tall. And for example, one of the towers is about the same height as the Statue of Liberty, which is pretty amazing if you think about it. I mean, it's a 1,000-year-old building. And so there are things like that, as I explained in the article, that they're not just one thing, but if you keep going through them, it was the most sophisticated monument of its time. And the Masons had encoded the sun and the moon on the two towers. And I explain in the article how the Jachin and Boaz pillars in Freemasonry, they have the sun and the moon on capped on them as well. So I show that the Masons in this particular building were really showing us that those twin towers at the facade, the western facade of the cathedral, were actually the Jachin and Boaz pillars. And it's the stuff like that, basically. I mean, I could go on and on, but it's really tough without photos. When you actually see the photos, it's much more interesting. Let me see. Let me think about what was. There's a labyrinth as well in the cathedral, and a labyrinth. Any labyrinth, and there's the idea of a labyrinth again, all ancient cultures, or not all, but most of them, 80%, 85% that I've studied had labyrinths, had, and they're not mazes, but they're labyrinths. A labyrinth, usually circular, and the whole idea is when you enter the labyrinth, you're supposed to go around it in a circle, and you're supposed to aim for the center of the circle. And the idea here being that's where you find the true self, the spiritual self, is when you kind of like the Tathagatagarbha Sutra that we talked about before, where at the center of all of us is the divine spark, and it's covered with outer layers, like an onion that we have to peel away, outer layers of greed, selfishness, lower self protection, anger, the lower emotions, that type of thing. And so the idea of a labyrinth is a very spiritual idea, and it teaches that we all have a divine spark within us. This is a heresy in the Christian tradition. We are not divine. We have to follow Jesus. We have to follow the church in order to ascend to heaven and become divine. This is the basic teaching. If we had divinity within us already, then what need do we have of the church? What need do we have of Jesus? What need do we have? So it's a complete contradiction. So the idea that the labyrinth teaches that we all have a divinity within us, a divine spark within us, is a heretical idea. And so the magic labyrinth inside of charts is a heresy. And there's other things as well. There was a fellow who his name is let me see, he's part of the Temenos Society. His name is Keith Critchlow, and he also showed how there's an amazing alignment between this labyrinth and the rose window and the western facade. He says that the labyrinth is, and I don't remember exactly how much, but let's just say 50 yards. The labyrinth, as you walk into the church from the front door, is 50 yards from the front door. And it, the rose window is exactly 50 yards up from the front door as well. So he's trying to show how the rose window and the labyrinth, both circular, have the same exact meaning. And the reason for that is because the rose window and the labyrinth are teaching the same idea, which again is to find the center, to peel away the outer layers of greed, et cetera, that we all have, and to find the Buddha within, the Christ within, the divine spark within us. And so, yeah, it's, to me, it's a very heretical cathedral, because if you understand how to read it, you'll see that the designers and the builders, who were Freemasons, were obviously not encoding the teachings of Christianity in that building. They were teaching the teachings of the universal religion of antiquity in that building. They had encoded this ancient wisdom in that building.
Hmm. Cool. Okay, let's talk about the Secret Owl Society now. I know there's an owl on the dollar bill that's hidden, but it is there if you can know where to look in the right place. And the whole Bohemian Grove thing, a lot of people may have seen that documentary where Alex Jones snuck into the Bohemian Grove and got the video footage there. So there's definitely some owl worship going on there. Moloch, I believe, is the name of the owl entity, but that has different names in other cultures. So tell us what this Secret Owl Society is all about.
Okay, so basically the Secret Owl Society article I wrote because I've studied a lot of, as I said before, secret societies and ancient cultures. It really comes from antiquity. The owl symbol comes from antiquity. And it's a symbol really of the balance of opposites. It's a symbol of finding the inner spark within us. And this is a very broad, you know, it stands for other things as well. But just very generally speaking, it's a symbol of the soul. It's a symbol of finding the true self within and doing that through the balance of opposites. And so it became, from an ancient symbol, it became a symbol of secret societies like the Freemasons, who had inherited these ancient teachings. And these ancient teachings, again, were part of the ancient universal religion that all the ancient cultures shared. So it was very, the owl symbol was always a very interesting symbol to me. And little by little, I began to realize that, you know, I can actually trace a lineage here. For example, in Leeds, which is in England, there's a city called Leeds where they actually today have an owl tour, where you can go and see different places where the Masons had encoded the owl into the architecture. And this is in the 1600s. This is a good 100 years before Freemasonry surfaced in 1717. So, and then from there, I found it at Yale in Connecticut, Yale University in New Haven, Connecticut. I actually lived in Stamford, which is not too far away. I used to take trips up to Yale and look at the architecture. There's neo-Gothic architecture across the campus. And I started to see the owl everywhere in Yale architecture. And you can see that in the article as well. I have photos. And that's around the 1700s. So that's about 100 years after Leeds. And little by little after that, I realized that it became an Illuminati symbol in the late 1700s. And then in the 1800s, another secret society called the Scarafia took over the owl. They used that as their symbol, and I see it. I began to see it on all their paraphernalia, all their what's the right word? But it's not paraphernalia, but all of their symbolism and all of their furniture and their architecture. From there, I traced it to the Bohemian Club because the owl symbol is one of the main symbols of the Bohemian Club in the 1800s. And then from there into the 1900s, the owl appears on the National Press Club. And also it was on the New York Herald building. And I forgot the name of the publisher of the New York Herald. What was his name? I completely forgot. Drawing a blank. But yeah, he was very much into owls. And the owl appeared not only on the building and the architecture, but in the newspaper and that type of thing. And then it was also in Disney. I at the time I had a very young son. This was 7 years ago, right? No, 6 years ago. And I was watching Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs with him. and I noticed that the owl is encoded in the whole entire movie, and it's not just an owl character, it's encoded in the actual architecture of the house, in the architecture of the chairs and things like that. And I have took some screen grabs from that and posted it in the article as well. And so the concept of the owl always interested me, and I just started to put together this little lineage, and I started to realize that it actually does form a lineage. And I kind of left it at that. I have more information that's coming. It's taken me a while. I posted the article, I think, in 2010. It's 2016 now, so I don't like to rush my research. I just, you know, I want to put things forward when I'm comfortable and when I've done my research properly. I know that a lot of people now just take this information and they post it on the internet without proper author citation. That's fine. I guess that's why I now watermark all my photos. But the ideas and the photos were originally from me, and you know, this is my research. I don't. I'm not interested in taking somebody else's work and elaborating on it. And if I did, I would provide proper author citation. But that's the times we live in.
Fair enough. If that's the way you want to do it, that's the way it's going to be. So I respect that. All right, I'd like to talk about another symbolism, the skull and crossbone symbol, not just with its connections to Yale University and George Bush and John Kerry both being running mates, not running mates, but facing each other in the same election and being at Yale, if you think that's a coincidence. And I got some nice oceanfront property off the coast of Mongolia that I'll sell you for $5. So, and George Bush was basically hinting, change the subject, when he was asked about that in his... So now you can start talking about the skull and bones symbol.
Okay, I mean, you know, just in terms of, you know, very quickly, the skull and bones society, I've found that secret societies in general, I mean, they have kids. These are human beings. They have families. They have children. And they want to expose their kids to ideas that are not necessarily taught in school, you know, like religious things, philosophical ideas, things like that. So I think these clubs, in my opinion, these clubs were started on campus originally for good reasons, not for bad. But just like Freemasonry has been hijacked, just like the U.S. government has been hijacked, I think, again, these two ideas, Freemasonry, the U.S. government, I think they both were started, I'm sure, they were both started for good and noble ends. It's just that over time, they were hijacked, they were taken and used by people who had different intentions. And I think I think the same thing happened, because when I look at these secret societies on campus, like the Skull and Bones has a triptych pattern right on their facade, right on the tomb facade. And I know what that symbol means. And the skull and crossbones itself is a very, very ancient and powerful symbol. And it's a very spiritual symbol. So in my opinion, the founders of the skull and bones had good intentions. It's just that, like the U.S. government, like Freemasonry, like other things, it was taken over. It was hijacked. And the people now that are in these clubs and governments, etc., have different intentions, and you know, to them, it's not the way it was when it was first started. So, I think that, and just as an example, if you look at the concept of the skull and bones, and there was a poster inside the skull and bones crypt that said, I think it was four skulls, and it was a German poster, and I think that said, which one or who was the fool, who the wise man, who was the beggar, and who was the king? It doesn't matter if you're poor or rich, we're all the same in death. And showing the four skulls like that, and showing that question, you know, which one of these guys was the philosopher, which was the king, you know, which one was, you can't tell because they're all skulls. Really what they're saying is that we're all equal. And also, it's kind of a message, kind of like a message to enjoy life now while you have it. And, you know, don't take anything for granted. It's kind of like the carpe diem, you know, seize the day. which, you know, eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow you're going to die. Momento, what is it called? Momento, my mind is mushy. It's a little late here, and I'm a little tired. It's sort of a reminder that you're going to die and that you should enjoy life, but it's more than that. It's a symbol of the idea that that you will live on. You won't just die because – and this is a little bit hard as well to communicate, but the whole idea of the two crossing of the bones there, that's a duality. And the skull itself in the middle of that duality symbolizes the middle doorway of the triptych, the balancing of the duality, and it's the dome, and it's the head, and it's the consciousness. So the dome and the head and the consciousness lives on. The spirit, the something in the middle lives on, and the duality dies, but the center part continues on, and the power is there, and the truth is there, and the eternity is in there. I explain it really well in the article. It's kind of hard to explain in person, but and I use symbols from Freemasonry and the Wizard of Oz and some other images also to explain it, and some good quotes. So I invite people to look at the article.
Thank you very much. And now I'd like to talk about another symbol of sorts, the God Self icon, which has many different appears in many different cultures and appears in many different types of ways. Basically, in a nutshell, it has some body, sometimes with one head, sometimes with more than one head, holding pillars on the sides in its hands with bent arms. So why don't you tell us what that God Self image symbol is all about?
Right. So the God Self icon is a discovery I made many years ago. I first published it in my 2011 book, Written in Stone. It's a worldwide symbol that I've discovered in many different cultures, like the ancient pre-Inca cultures in Peru and Bolivia. It's in Mexico among the Maya and Aztec and Toltec, Olmec cultures. I've found it in North America among ancient cultures that existed in North America. I found it in Africa, not just among the ancient Egyptians, but in Nigeria. I've also found it in Europe, and I've found it in the Middle East. I found it in Persia, in China, in India. It's everywhere. It's basically everywhere. And what it is, I call it the God Self icon. It's known to archaeologists in the New World as the Staff God, and it's known to archaeologists in the Old World as the Master of Animals or Master of Beasts, or it has different names in the Old World. But what I proposed in my 2011 book was that it's the same symbol. It's the symbol, it's the lost symbol of the ancient worldwide religion. And it teaches the same exact ideas as the triptych does, which is the balance of opposites, to find the center within. And again, as I said earlier, the left side of the body and the left hand is the moon side, the yin side, the female side, and the right side of the body is the solar side, the male side. And so those are the two dualities. And when the staff god or the master of animals is holding twin objects symmetrically in those hands facing forward, what they're saying is, I have firm grasp of both dualities. I'm a master of both of these dualities. And that's exactly what the ancient universal religion teaches. That's the main concept of the Egyptian religion. It's the main concept of the Inca and pre-Inca religions, of the Mayan religion, China, India. That's it right there. That the idea is to, again, this is what we said in the beginning of the interview, which is that in order to become a whole person, you have to encompass both sides of the duality, and that balance strikes that you strike makes you whole, and you can identify and assimilate your dark side and that type of thing. So the God Self icon is basically the lost symbol of an ancient worldwide religion. I explained that in my 2011 book Written in Stone, and that's the subject. I fleshed that whole idea out in my recent book that I published this year, 2016, The Missing Link. And as I explained in The Missing Link, that is that's the evidence beyond the triptych that we have, beyond the pyramids, beyond the other world parallels, that there was an ancient universal religion. So I show not only visual evidence that there was an ancient worldwide religion, you know, the God Self icon being visual evidence, but I show how each of these cultures also had as their main religious thought or main philosophy the idea of the balance of opposites, finding the middle way. When a person holds those two symmetrical objects in each hand facing forward, that those two things are the duality, and the actual vertical line that their body, their head and torso and pelvis, that vertical line that they form is the center door of the triptych, is the center, the balance point of the duality. And it's so, it's almost becomes like a yoga pose, like a yogic pose. And this concept is also the God Self icon is also associated with the awakening of the third eye, because as I explain in the book, a lot of these God Self icons are depicted with the third eye and with the awakened third eye on their own forehead and with the Aten symbol or sun disk above them, which is a symbol of the third eye. It's a symbol of the soul within, or the source of creation, the spiritual source. And so it's a tremendous discovery, and it's one that I've only really just begun to talk about and write about. I've got already the idea in two books, and I'm finding it in even more places all over the world. I recently moved to Spain in 2015, and the biggest monument in the National Archaeological Museum, it's called the Pozo Moro. It's an ancient monument, and it has a God Self icon on it, and it's supposedly a pre-Roman. They date it to, I think, 800 BC, and it has a giant God Self icon on it. Fascinating. I love it. It's really an important discovery, and I think that you've probably seen the image all over the internet, again without proper author attribution, but that's okay. But yeah, this is something that I discovered, and it's something that I originally published on my 2011 book written in stone.
Thank you very much. And once again, I'm going to have to hang up on you because we're at the 10-minute mark. But as soon as we get...
Okay, so real quick. Excuse me. The lion's gaze, don't want to get into the symbolism of the lion, but you know, a lot of ancient cultures use the lion, sphinxes and that type of thing. And there's so much we can talk about with the lion, but just for this this one article, there was a how do I explain it? There's a saying, and I think it was Milarepa. I'm paraphrasing here, but the whole idea really is, if you're engaged in the great work, and the great work being, you know, working on yourself, working on peeling those layers of onion or peeling those layers of materiality and greed, etc., that we talked about before, you're working on yourself. That's called the great work of self-mastery, self-development, self-understanding, etc. And people who are engaged in that great work are basically they're making.
Yeah, Richard, I didn't hang up on you. The Skype had a glitch on its own there.
Okay, I was going to say, it didn't sound like the 10-minute mark.
it wasn't, but yeah, we're at the very last part of the Mercury retrograde, so maybe this is when things get really crazy. That's my hunch, but anyway, just, let's not let it bother us. Keep going.
Oh, good. As long as the ground doesn't start shaking, we're good.
Yeah.
All right, so not sure where it cut off, but I was saying that, you know, it's the whole idea basically is this: when you throw a stick at a dog, the dog chases after the stick. But when you throw a stick at a lion, something totally different happens. Instead of chasing the stick, it chases you, the thrower of the stick. And so, in a nutshell, the idea is that the stick that's being thrown, it signifies a problem that we might have in our life, and it brings feelings of annoyance or frustration, even hostility, and that's what problems happen. When problems happen, that's what we feel. So if we focus our attention on the problem, it's like chasing after the stick. We're like a dog chasing after the stick. We're trying to make the problem go away, and this is a mistake according to the lion's gaze. What we don't realize is that the real problem is not in the physical world. It's in the inner world, the world inside us. And so the problem that appears in the outer world is just a symptom of this more deeper, more interior problem that we have, this inner problem, because the outer world is a mirror reflection of the inner world. This is a concept in the occult. So having the gaze of the lion, it just means that we turn our attention inward and look within ourselves for what the real problem is. And so a lion has a direct gaze. It focuses directly at the source. And the lion itself is a fearless creature, a wise and fearless animal. And it charges directly at the source. So by addressing the inward imperfection or inward imbalance that's causing the outer world problem, we're addressing the source of the problem rather than the symptom. And that's what it is to have the lion's gaze. And Milarepa tells us, be like a lion who does not chase after the stick. He turns and faces the thrower of the stick. Don't be like a dog chasing after the stick. And the famous quote that he says is, you only throw a stick at a lion once. Meaning, you know, you're not like the dog. The lion is not like a dog. The lion will charge after the thrower of the stick, not the stick itself.
Yeah, that seems to especially hold true when it comes to doctors nowadays. I wish they would treat the causes and not the symptoms. But then again, there's a medical monopoly, so they can't really do that easily without getting hassled for it. But that's another story. Another article here, Hidden Italy, the Forbidden Cyclopean Ruins of Giants from Atlantis. And that's a question there, of giants from Atlantis. Cyclopean, that has connections to the word Cyclops. Some controversy over where the mythology of the Cyclops came from, whether there was an actual Cyclops-like creature that was genetically engineered, as ancient astronaut theorists might say, or whether the Cyclops came from bones of like some elephant-like creature that people mistook for like where the trunk of the creature was in the skull. They thought that looked like a giant eye, so that made them think that that was a giant eye in the middle of the forehead that the Cyclops had, and that's where the myth, they say, came from. And there's also the myth that Cyclopses were the ones that built some of these ruins. And when it comes to giants from Atlantis, are you talking about Nephilim giants? You're talking about maybe Anunnaki giants, like Zachariah Sitchin would talk about? So why don't you clear up a lot of the controversy and confusion here about what's meant by Cyclopean, Cyclops, giants, where they come from, and also the ruins in Italy in general?
Sure. The whole article is based on the reality that throughout Italy, there are what are called and what have historically been called Cyclopean ruins. And these ruins are very, very interesting because they are formed with massive stones. Some of them are perfectly cut. Some of them are interlocking. Some of them are polygonal. Some of them are shaped in such ways that it's hard for us to relate to them. And so, historically speaking, Cyclopean masonry is a kind of stonework that were attributed to a mythical race of giants called the Cyclopes. And supposedly only they had the strength to move these boulders because some of them were so massive. And so you have many of the classical writers and historians like Homer, Hesiod, Plutarch, and I think Diodorus Siculus also explained in their writings that the Cyclopean ruins of Italy and of Europe in general were built by this race of giants. And so it's a very interesting idea because is it possible that there's some truth to this? It might not be exactly true that there was a one-eyed race of giants that built these monuments, but could there be some truth? Now, remember what we said before, the whole idea of the third eye being the universal religion of antiquity. The Egyptians, the Hindus, the Maya, etc., they all built pyramids, they all built triptych temples, and they all had the third eye as a major part of their religion. The whole concept of a cyclops is a human being with a third eye, awakened. And remember, these are stone monuments, the stonemasons, the master masons. The builders of the Cyclopean monuments were master masons. And so it's the article is basically me asking, is it possible that these Cyclopean ruins are in some way connected to a mythical or perhaps not so mythical race of men or group of men or group of master masons who built these monuments because they had awakened some element within their own nature that allowed them to find the center and to lift the stones and cut the stones and maneuver the stones in such a way that to our modern gaze, it looks impossible, or it looks like something that we can't even relate to. The idea of Atlantis, and this is important as well, there's a historical tradition that's linked to Atlantis. It says that the Atlanteans possessed a third eye awakened in the forehead, and that's why they were so spiritual. The concept of a third eye is that where your two eyes see inward, where your two eyes look outward at material things in the material world, your single third eye looks inward and sees the divine aspect within you, your soul within. And you become empowered by that experience. When you have an awakened third eye, when your third eye chakra is awakened, when your pineal gland is opened, you are able to not only see the divine within you, but you're able to operate from that higher perspective. And in some ways, not in every way, but in some ways, you're able to control and manipulate the dream. They say life is a dream. You're able to control and manipulate some aspects of it, not all of it, some aspects. And so the idea has been handed down through history that the Atlanteans had an awakened third eye. They were the third eye race. And over time, the third eye atrophied, becoming concealed by the flesh. And as we talked about before, the Golden Age became the Silver Age. The Silver Age became the Bronze Age, all the way down to where we're living today, the Kali Yuga, where we have almost completely forgotten about the third eye, and where we only have memories of some distant ancient third eye symbol that the Hindus put a dot there in the middle of the head, and the Egyptians also, and some of the other ancient cultures also did that because they, being closer to the Golden Age than we are, had a much more had the third eye as a much more important aspect of their civilization and their religion. They were much closer to the Golden Age than we are today, so they all had a stronger memory of the third eye, and that's because they lived closer to the Golden Age and they lived closer to the time of Atlantis. So the idea that the Cyclopean monuments in Italy were designed and built by men who had an awakened third eye is pretty, in my opinion, is pretty strong. There's good evidence because the monuments themselves are incredible. They're attributed to the Cyclopes, not just by the last people in the last several hundred years, but by ancient accounts. And again, we have Freemasonry, which has come down to us, their main symbol being the Cyclopean Eye, because the third eye was often in history called the Cyclopean Eye. And so there's a connection. These are stone monuments, master masons, Cyclopean third eye, Masonic third eye, strong connections there. And nobody's talking about this. Everybody's kind of confused, I think. They're associating Freemasonry with the Illuminati. They're associating the ancient monuments with some kind of advanced technology that we no longer or that we have now again rediscovered today, like drills and sawzalls and things like that. I don't see any of that. I don't see that at all. I see masterful stonemasons having created these ancient monuments because they had awakened an element within them.
All right, you were saying about how the third eye gave them all the power to build these things?
Right, yeah, because in order to do anything, you really have to be – you can't be all in the action field. You have to be centered. A runner, for example, cannot run a race if he's all in the action field. There's a center that has to be held and known and focused if you're going to do anything. Of greatness, like running a race and winning a race. You know, that's just one example. Dancing, building a monuments in stone, that type of stuff. You have to be in the center for this type of stuff. And so to me, it all makes sense. It all links beautifully. It's just a matter of putting the symbolism in the right place where they belong. And really, it's very simple to understand if you really understand the symbols of Freemasonry. It's all written in the symbols. You see, if you go and become a Mason, they don't teach you this anymore. It's all about fishing trips and you know, lottery and helping the poor and that type of stuff. You know, there's a lot of charity work. And really what the organization was founded on is the symbolism. And if you look at the symbolism, it's all there. It teaches you the Ida and Pingala channels or the Jachin and Boaz pillars. You put those in balance and you awaken the all-seeing eye in the middle. That's the core of it, and that's on all the tracing boards. And the reason I wrote the book and called it Written in Stone is because this same idea of the awakened third eye or the awakened cyclopean eye is encoded in all the Gothic cathedrals, and it's encoded in all the Masonic architecture in Washington, D.C., and in every city in the United States and in Europe as well and other parts of the world as well. It is inherited from antiquity. It's written in stone in the pyramids of Egypt. It's written in stone in all the great ancient monuments of antiquity.
Thank you very much. Another symbol here that's in different parts of the world. It's mostly associated with Egypt, but it's here it appears in Mexico, and you suggest it was built by the Aztecs, the Ankh symbol. Now, what is the Ankh? Some have suggested there's a connection between Ankh and Anunnaki because they sound somewhat similar, but I think maybe that might be a bit of a stretch there. What do you think the Ankh is, and where's the evidence that, yes, this is truly the Ankh from Egypt and not something that just looks like it?
Well, you know, just as somebody who studied the religions of Mexico and Mesoamerica in general, the whole concept of these religions is the balance of the opposites. That's the whole core of the religion. And to not understand that is simply to not understand Mesoamerican cultures, you know. And if you look at Egypt, it's the same exact core teaching in the Egyptians as well. And in my books, I show how scholars say that. I'm not going against any scholars. In fact, I quote scholars all throughout my work to show that the idea of the balance of the opposites, the left and the right, the yin and the yang, this is a central concept in Mexico and of the Aztecs and also the Olmec, the Maya, the Toltec. All the cultures all believed that very, very strongly. It was a major part of their civilization. And so when you recognize that and when you recognize that it was the same teaching in Egypt for thousands of years, and when you see Egyptologists and you read the books, the scholarly texts, and they talk about it over and over again, it's very clear that the pyramids in the New World in Mexico and the pyramids in the Old World in Egypt have a connection. And so what other symbols do we see that both cultures have? Here's the Ankh cross right here. Boom. It's a temple, and it's exactly very, very parallel to the Ankh cross in Egypt. I wrote this article in 2012. I've since seen my photo appear on other websites and Facebook pages. Again, no proper author citation, but that's okay. But the Ankh cross, like any cross, the idea of a cross, you know, being there's a – usually it stands for duality, but here it stands for the duality, the intermingling of the spiritual and the material. Anytime you have a vertical line, you have vertical and horizontal, those two lines usually make the cross. The vertical line is the spiritual part. You know, think again of the Kundalini, where we talked about before, the God Self icon. You have a person standing there vertically. That vertical part is the center door of the triptych. It's the spiritual part, whereas the two arms outstretched are kind of almost forming a crucifix, right? You have the left arm and the right arm. That horizontal line is the material part. And you'll even see some images of Christ where his left hand is capped by a moon symbol and his right hand is capped by a sun symbol. And that's esoteric Christianity showing us that the left side of the body, again, being the yin side, and the right side of the body being the yang side. So the idea of a cross, and here the Ankh cross is a spiritual symbol. It just explains that we have a divinity within us. We have an eternal part of us that is the vertical axis, and we have a horizontal part, which is the material part. So it's the crossing of the two that makes a person, and it's the teaching basically in essence that you are that within. That's you are divine. You are divine already. You are a God already. You have eternity. You have eternal consciousness within you already. And it's almost an anthropomorphic symbol. It looks like it's shaped like a person. If you look at a cross, it has the head, it has the two arms, and the torso or the body, the two legs united as one. It looks human. So that's a symbol. That's an esoteric symbol showing us that it has something to do with our own constitution, because it has that symbol. It has that. It looks like a human being.
Yeah, I never thought of that. That it does, now that I think about it. All right, moving on to another article here. Alien messages detected, proof we're not alone, hidden in the sun and moon. Now, when I think of the sun and moon proving that we're not alone, I think, well, in the case of the moon is an artificial body. A lot of evidence there. Not going to get into it. And also the sun, a lot of video of the sun showing what appear to be giant spacecraft or maybe giant space creatures sucking energy out of the sun. That could be taken as evidence, or some would go off the deep end and say proof that we're not alone. But I'm guessing the evidence and proof that we're not alone in regards to the sun and moon is completely different from the stuff I just mentioned. So tell us what this is all about.
Okay, we could, just using Freemasonry here, the tracing boards and other Masonic images show us that there's the Jakin and Boaz pillars in Freemasonry, and the Jakin pillar on the right usually has the sun on top of it, and the Boaz pillar has the moon on top of it. And of course, as I've said already before, the centered third eye is in the middle. So I did a lot of research on the sun and the moon, and I started to realize how parallel the two are. And if you really look at it, there, in my opinion, are no coincidences regarding the nature of these parallels. So just as an example, if you look at history and esoteric teachings at such and such, the sun was always symbolic of the yang, and the moon was always symbolic of the yin. So they have the sun being the male, the yang, the moon being the female, the yin. But then you could take that a little bit one step further, and you can look at it and you can say, well, if you think about it, the sun is in the day and the moon is in the night, and day and night are opposites. And the day is kind of light out, and the night is obviously dark. So light and dark are opposites. And the light brings heat, right? But the dark brings cold, and hot and cold are opposites. And the hot brings dry, but the cold brings moist, and dry and moist are opposites. And usually day symbolizes life and vitality, but night symbolizes death and stillness. So life is considered good, obviously, but death is considered evil. So all down the line, we really have almost encoded in our lives, the idea that the sun and the moon, the day and the night, the light and the dark, the hot and the cold, the dry and the moist, life and death, good and evil, these are all the pairs of opposites in the world, and they're all symbolized by the sun and the moon, which are shown in Freemasonry, and not just Freemasonry, by the way, but in all the secret societies and also all the ancient cultures. So the sun and the moon are really, really important symbols for anybody that's on the path, that's trying to perform the great work, and anybody who's interested in learning more about not just who they are, but what kind of a world they live in. You have to study the sun and the moon, and that's what I did. And I started to learn even more that, for example, if you look at the sun and the moon from the perspective of darkness and light, if you take the average, there's 12 hours of light and 12 hours of darkness. That's exactly half each. So on top of all the duality that I just mentioned, you have half light and half dark. And so that's another example of there being opposites. And of course, the more important and the most important
phenomenon.
Okay, yeah. So the thing that really pushes it for me beyond coincidence, and this is beyond coincidence, is not only the pairs of opposites that we talked about, but again, the 12 hours of day and 12 hours of night, but the idea that the sun and the full moon are the exact same size when viewed from Earth. This is unbelievable, and this is not a coincidence. This, if anybody really is a philosopher and anybody really looks at that, first of all, looking at the parallels, looking at how the sun and the moon, again, symbolize all these pairs of opposites and all the duality, they're responsible for all the pairs of opposites that we experience in our life. But they're also the same size in our sky. This is not a coincidence. Now, all of a sudden, you're pushed into higher consciousness. You're pushed into recognizing something special is going on here. And that something special is otherworldly. Now, I don't know what the source is, but it's definitely not normal. It's definitely not a coincidence. It almost seems to me, and this is why I wrote the article, and I, you know, the article, like most of the other articles on my website, are spin-offs from parts of the books that I've written. This idea is teaching me, is showing me that some intelligence put the sun and the moon in our sky that way. Maybe it was a golden age civilization that had such extreme power that they could do that. I don't know. Maybe it was an alien civilization or an extraterrestrial civilization. I don't know. But I do know that the sun and the moon being the same size in our sky, on top of all the other phenomena that I talked about with duality and et cetera, is beyond coincidence. And so that's the reason I wrote the article. There is something very, very special about this this place that we're living. Yes, it's illusion. Yes, it's a dream. Yes, we're living in a dark age. But it's a magical place, and we should never lose sight of that. You know, that's why I like Alan Watts and I like Joseph Campbell. Most of my work is based on their view of the world, which is that, you know, no matter what, we're living in a magical place. This is, if you know how to approach life, it's a magical place, and you can control parts of it. It is a dream. Life is a dream. And I, you know, most of my work shows how a lot of the philosophers throughout the last several centuries talked about that. And there's even nursery rhymes devoted to it. Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 merrily. Life is just a dream. Life is but a dream. The idea is very, very important, because you can control the dream if you know how to use these symbols, if you know how to call upon your willpower, understand and recognize your own divinity. And there's a whole system of magic that's set up for this. The crafts of the medieval times, and, you know, I'm not sure if you've ever had any guests on that are experts in magic, but they'll tell you that, you know, a lot of their work is based on the sun and the moon. It's a very important part of magic, and I don't want to get into it right now, but it's very key to performing certain functions, certain rituals, that type of thing.
Cool. All right, we'll probably have to do just two more subjects. Let's kill two birds with one stone here. I'll hang up on you one more time, and then we'll finish up when I hang you back on there. But let's two birds with one stone here. Secrets of the swastika and the three wise monkey symbols. So what are those all about?
Okay, yeah, the ancient secret of the swastika is – the swastika has always been a fascinating symbol to me. I've always enjoyed you know, looking at the history, and the history of the swastika is what interested me. You know, as somebody who was always interested in archaeology, I knew at a very young age that the swastika was found all over ancient Europe. And so from, you know, ancient Rome to ancient Greece, it's found on the Iberian Peninsula. It's found in England. It's found everywhere in Europe. In ancient Europe, the symbol is everywhere. And so I was always curious to know why, and I really decided to investigate this when I was probably in my mid-20s, and I learned that there's a major history behind the swastika, and not only just in the in Europe, but in other parts of the world as well. In the New World, for example, in North America, they found the swastika, in Peru, etc. But the place where we really have information on the swastika is India. And so you see it connected to Hinduism in India. And, of course, in India we have Hinduism. We have the third eye religion. Hinduism is a third eye religion. And so without getting too deeply into the subject, I learned that the swastika religion of Hinduism, let's say, was the original religion of ancient Europe and ancient European peoples before Christianity. And that's what I explain in my books, and that's what I explain in my article. And there's no doubting that. There's because the swastika itself is a symbol of Hinduism. And so, and there's other things as well that prove this. But one, for example, the mother tongue of all the European languages, the mother language of them all, is Sanskrit, which is the ancient language of India. And so there's a strong connection and between ancient Europe and India. And if you read some of what Blavatsky wrote, for example, Helena Blavatsky, she said that there was an entrance of the people, and this concept is even found in academia, that the people of Europe originally came from India, and they took their Hindu religion with them and their swastika religion with them when they entered Europe, and that's why the pre-Christian religion of Europe was Hinduism with a swastika. And I find that fascinating. And I did a lot of research on it. And you'll find that research in Written in Stone. But in these articles, I kind of give an introduction into that idea. And I don't go into it too deeply, but it is a part of academia. It is historically, it's been a part of academia. And even today, there are a great number of academics who believe in it. It is a controversial theory. It has to do with a controversy that's called the Aryan invasion of India, which I don't want to get into right now, but it has to do basically with the history and to some extent the mythology of India. But the idea that the ancient ruins of Europe have swastikas, the pottery and some of the mosaics and some of the other symbols and jewelry that's been found in ancient Europe is covered with the swastika is fascinating to me. And the whole idea is that there's a connection to Hinduism there and the connection to the third eye religion of ancient India. And so that's the swastika. The other one that you mentioned is the three wise monkeys, which is another symbol that I always enjoyed, and just wrote a short article on it saying how, see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil is not really what we think it is. It's a matter of really living a life that where we're not really exposed to evil things. You know, the more that we see it, and think of like modern movies, you know, the more that we see it, the more that we become desensitized to it, and the more that we allow it to penetrate our lives, and we almost become that. I think the American society today is an example of that, and I guess this is a good place to end it. You know, I've been living in Europe for the past year and a half, and one thing that I'm really, really surprised at is what a difference. You know, people here, the men here are gentlemen. Not that there's no gentlemen in the U.S., but I'm starting to see how barbaric the United States is. You know, when you see all these shootings and the violence in the schools. I mean, that's not here yet. I think it's coming. I think it's coming, and I see the beginnings of it. But I think that you can trace all that to the movies and to the television shows, because a lot of it is social engineering. They're engineering people to be rough and violent and angry. I'm probably going to write an article called The Angry Americans soon, because the American people are angry, and there's something to that. I think the reason for that is they're watching too much of the television and the movies that are making them either scared, which in turn is creating this mentality of you know, anger and aggressiveness. But I don't know what it is, but I think that it's the media, it's the television, it's the news, it's the music. It's very, very violent. And I think the more you see it, the more you become that. The more you see it or hear it, you know, so see no evil, hear no evil. Okay. So, yeah, so the whole idea is, you know, see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. It's an ancient concept. And in fact, Gandhi, I think Gandhi, in the article I explained that Gandhi always had a little statue of the three monkeys at his side or on his person or in his office or whatever it was. The idea is that if you don't see it and you don't hear it, you won't speak it. And so, you know, I try to not see so much violence in my day-to-day, you know, activities. It's everywhere, even online. I mean, no matter where you click, you're going to see it. But I try not to indulge my curiosity if I see something that looks bad, or I try not to watch these types of movies where it is something sick going on. I almost feel like it's contaminating me, and I don't like that feeling. I don't want to be a part of that. I'd rather see good things, nice things. And I think that's, as I said before, I think that's part of what's wrong with American society.
Well, America's the Roman Empire of the modern era, so it kind of stands to reason that that will be reflected in some way. But we're supposed to see the collapse of the Roman Empire of the modern era soon, and I and all the other Americans will have to bear the brunt of that, but in the end, it's going to be totally worth it. And I beg to differ when you say all the angerness is going to come to Europe. No, I think that when the Roman Empire of the modern era falls, all that anger that could go to Europe isn't going to reach there, and people will ultimately be a lot happier, and this plan to bring illegal immigrants and refugees into the countries is going to backfire and all the rest of it. But I'm trying to be optimistic there, and I see that happening. So I think we'll end the show now. Sorry for all the glitches and all. I tried to suck it up and deal with it, and I'm going to make sure that this doesn't happen next time I have to do a Skype-to-Skype pre-record for a show. It was great having you on, and I suppose if you ever need, like, a medium, not that I'm the best person to do this, I'm sure there's better people that are better than me at this, but better radio hosts and all that can be a medium for you to get information out, but if you ever want to, like, come on my show again to do, like, a half an hour to an hour special to discuss something important that you find, by all means, give me a buzz. However, as far as me contacting you and all my other previous guests goes, ever since I started doing the show, I've always been on a mission to try to get as many different people on my show as I can, because I felt that that was the fairest, most impartial, and most informative way to do a show. So if I don't contact you to come on a show, please understand that's only because I need to give thousands of other fascinating individuals like you a chance to have some glory on my show. And if I do get the show on Capricorn Radio, then, well, I suppose I could bring previous guests, because that never have the same guest twice policy wouldn't definitely not apply, because I got a new show. So I definitely put you and all my other previous guests up for grabs. But if you ever find something important, I want to come on this show specifically, Nature of Reality Radio, give me buzz. I can certainly accommodate you with a half an hour to an hour special, like I've done with some other previous guests that have contacted me. But I loved having you on. You did enlighten me on a lot of things here, and even though a lot of people would say that this Illuminati secret society stuff is not really worth talking about in this age, we should focus on love, hey, I beg to differ. There's a lot of people that need to wake up to this stuff, and it's a great thing that I'm having people like you to come on to wake up the people that still need an awakening. Thank you, Richard. It was a great interview.
Great. Thanks very much, Andrew. I really appreciate it. Yeah, thanks for the invitation, for today, and thanks for the future invitation. It was great talking to you as well, and I really wish you the best of luck with your new show, and good luck to you.
Yeah, good luck to you.
Take care. All right, now. Andrew, take care. Have a good night.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye.